Bam, Mr. True. In this video, in the next few videos, we're going to be discussing sequences and ultimately series. We'll be discussing, let's see here, my notes show recursion formulas, summation notations, defining for you the factorial symbol if you need it, if you haven't seen that before. And then in later videos, moving into arithmetic sequences and series and geometric sequences and series. But for right now, let's get this basic idea of a sequence out of the way. An infinite sequence, a sub n, is a function whose domain is the set of all positive integers. That is, we're talking about the values of n. This is brand new notation. This is actually a fairly simple topic. The notations are all new, though, so it can be confusing. The sort of independent variable, if you will, the domain is this value of n. You'll see how this works with examples. And the domain is a set of all positive integers. The function values, which is going to be expressed with this a sub n notation, it's kind of like f of x, only it's notation for a sequence. The function values, or terms, of the sequence are represented by a sub 1, a sub 2, a sub 3. Here is n is equaling 1. You're putting it into an expression and you're getting your a sub 1 value. Now you're plugging in an n value of 2 and getting your a sub 2 value and so on until you get to a sub n. And then there's a little dot, dot, dot at the end because we're defining an infinite sequence. Now, if there is an ending point, if I were to cover up those dot, dot, dots and say the last term in the sequence is a sub n, well, then you're discussing or you're looking at a finite sequence. So, that's the definition. That's the difference between an infinite and a finite sequence. Let's get some examples out of the way, shall we? So here are two examples. A sub n is equal to negative 3n plus 5, and a sub n is equal to negative 2 to the n power over 2 to the n plus 1. And the directions say write the first five terms of each sequence and then graph it. So what that means is I want to know what a sub 1 is, a sub 2, a sub 3, a sub 4, and a sub 5. Well, this means that n equals 1, n equals 2, n equals 3, n equals 4, and n equals 5. And we're just going to plug these values of 1 through 5 into the expression. And remember, n is defined as a positive integer, so the lowest value that n can take on is 1. So we have negative 3 times 1 plus 5, and negative 3 times 2 plus 5, and negative 3 times 3 plus 5, and so on. So what does that mean? That means that we've got negative 3 times 1 is negative 3, and then negative 3 plus 5 is equal to 2. So a sub 1 is equal to 2. Now we're going to plug in the value of 2. Negative 3 times 2 is negative 6, and negative 6 times 5 is negative 1. Now let's let n equal 3. Negative 3 times 3. Let's let n equal 3, make sure I said that right. Negative 3 times positive 3 is negative 9, and negative 9 plus 5 is negative 4. Now let's let n equal 4 and find a sub 4. Negative 3 times 4 is negative 12, and negative 12 plus 5 is negative 7. And you might be noticing that my values are going down by a consistent value of 3. And that is because, well, it's negative 3 times n. It's a linear function, if you will. But just for practice, again, letting n equal 5 to find a sub 5, negative 3 times 5, negative 3 times 5 is negative 15, and negative 15 plus 5 is equal to negative 10. Let's get these dotted lines out of the way. It looks like I'm writing 17. Okay, so boom, 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 and boom. All right. Now, as far as graphing these, let's move this line out of the way. Remember what you just copied in the previous screen where it said the domain of a sequence is a set of all positive integers? The domain is a set of all positive integers. When you're looking at a graph, you know, we're used to graphing, you know, smooth and continuous graphs like parabolas and lines, or smooth and continuous. Well, if I look at my values here, I'm going to graph this, and instead of calling this my x-axis, I'm going to call it my n-axis, because n in a sequence is the value that you're plugging in. It's your independent variable. And the y-axis, instead of just x and y, we're plugging in n and getting out a sub n values. So I'm going to call this my a sub n axis. So my values that I plugged in were 1 through 5, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I got y values, or a sub n values, between 2 and negative 10. So I'm going to have to carry this down quite a bit farther. And we got 1, 2, and then negative 1, negative 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and negative 10. And let's put negative 5 there. So we had a point of, I plugged in 1 and got 2. So when n was 1, a sub n was 2. I plugged in 2 and got negative 1. So when n was 2, I got negative 1 as an answer. When n was 3, a sub 3 was negative 4. When n was 4, a sub 4 was negative 7. So 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm sorry about standing in front of you. I just want to try and make sure this is straight. And then finally, when n was 5, a sub 5 was equal to negative 10. Now, it's very, very tempting to go, oh, well, I'm making a straight line. But if I were to make a straight line, I would be indicating with my graph that all values of n were included in the domain. But n, what you plug into a sequence expression, by definition, is the positive integer. So we are definitely talking about a set of, you know, just a set of discrete points, not a continuous line representing an infinite number of possibilities or an infinite number of points, or indicating my domain is all real numbers. My domain is only the positive integers. So that's the first example. Let me get this out of my way because I think I'm going to need the space. And let's find, for this example now, a sub 1. Now, a sub 1 means that n equals 1. So we got negative 2 to the 1 power over 2 to the first power plus 1. That's going to be negative 2 over 2 plus 1, which is equal to negative 2 thirds. And now we're going to find a sub 2, which means we got negative 2 squared over 2 squared plus 1. Which, now when you start raising a negative number to powers, when the power is even, the negative is going to cancel away. When the power is odd, like it was up in the first example, the negative is going to stay there. So our a sub n values are going to oscillate a lot because of this negative number in my parentheses. Negative 2 squared is negative 2 times negative 2, which is 4. And I got 2 squared is 4 plus 1 is 5. So we have 4 fifths. We have a sub 3, which is going to be negative 2 to the third over 2 to the third plus 1. That's going to be negative 2 to the third is negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2, which is negative 8 over 2 to the third, which is 8 plus 1, which is 9. So a sub 3 is equal to negative 8 over 9. And we're going to find the first 5, and I'm just going to kind of be quiet here for a second and see if you can figure out what a sub 4 and a sub 5 are with the same type of substitution. Maybe you want to pause the tape and pause the video and work on that. Or let me just give you the answers. A sub 4 comes out to be 16 over 7. 16 over 17, and a sub 5 ends up coming out to be negative 32 over 33. So let's get this graphed. We have Remember, this was, let me just leave some footnotes here. N equals 1, N equal 2, N equal 3, right here, right? N equals 4, and N equals 5. So, our graph, negative 0.5 and negative 1, positive 0.5 and positive 1, because all of my fractional answers are between negative 1 and 1, and my n values, again, were between 1 and 5, or were 1 and 5, 1 through 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is, again, the my n-axis and my a sub n-axis. So when a, when n equals 1, a sub 1 was negative 2 thirds, so when n equaled 1, we were a little bit past negative 0.5. When n was 2, we got 4 fifths, so when n was 2, we got 4 fifths, which is 0.9, a little bit closer to the 1 than we were to the negative 1. When n was 3, we got negative 8 ninths, so that's getting a little bit closer, we're just basically getting closer and closer to either positive 1 or negative 1. When n is 4, we got 16 17ths, which is very close to 1. And that's all that's going to happen, is we're going to keep getting closer and closer to either 1 or negative 1 as our n values get larger. And at 5, we end up with negative 32 over 33. So, that is how you find terms in a sequence with your a sub n expression, and also how you graph. Make sure if you do graph these that you do not connect the dots, as tempting as that is, because the domain of a sequence is all positive integers. Let's move on to the next topic in this video. Recursion formulas. They define the nth term of a sequence as a function of the previous term. Now, as we move through this topic, we're going to be doing problems where we're given a list of numbers, a sequence or series, and we have to come up with a general equation that explains or gives us that sequence of numbers. Basically, you know, notice the pattern and write an equation. Now, recursion formulas are much easier to come up with than the general formula that I'll be preferring my students give me, and you'll see in these examples why. Now, recursion formulas is a topic we have to cover. They do have its place, but we don't prefer them because, well, what it says, the nth term of a sequence is a function of the previous term. So, while it's easier to come up with recursion formulas when you're looking at the list of numbers in your sequence, if you want the 10th number in the sequence, you have to do the previous 9. You can't go straight to the 10th one. A general formula, a general a sub n formula will do that for you. But let's just see how these recursion formulas work. A sub 1 equals 3, and I want to find where my sequence is defined as a sub n is equal to 3 times a sub n minus 1. The subscript means that I want you to go to the number just previous to the one you're trying to find. So we have to be told what the first number is in the sequence because we're going to use it to find the next number in the sequence. And we're going to do this for n values greater than or equal to 2. Because we already know that when n equals 1, our first value is 3. A sub 1 is equal to 3. So, well, a sub 1 is equal to 3. So a sub 2 is equal to 3 times a sub n minus 1, or 2 minus 1, minus 5. Well, a sub 2 minus 1 is a sub 1, and a sub 1 is equal to 3. So we have 3 times a sub 1, which is 3, minus 5, and 9 minus 5 is equal to 4. Okay, let's move on to the next one. A sub 3. Whoops, that's ugly. How about a sub 3 is equal to, well, 3 times a sub 3 minus 1 minus 5. A sub 3 minus 1, well, is 2. So 3 times a sub 2, which is equal to 4, so 3 times 4 minus 5, 3 times 4 is 12, and 12 minus 5 is equal to 7. A sub 4 is equal to 3 times a sub 4 minus 1 minus 5. So it's 3 times, well, 4 minus 1 is 3. So a sub 3 is equal to 7 minus 5. And 3 times 7 is 21. And 21 minus 5 is 16. And then finally, a sub 5, I'm going to skip the notation here. A sub 5 is 3 times the previous value in our sequence, which is 16, minus 5. 3 times 10 is 30. 3 times 6 is 18. 30 and 18 is 48. 48 minus 5 is 43. So A sub 1 equals 3. A sub 2 equals 4. A sub 3 equals 7. A sub 4 equals 16. And A sub 5 is equal to 43. Okay. If I wanted a sub 6, I could not go straight from a sub 1 to a sub 6. I'd have to work through these lines. So, again, recursion formulas are easy to use, easy to come up with, but you know, will not allow you to get to any one particular point in a sequence. You have to start from the beginning and work your way to whatever value you'd like. One more time, here we got some yellow chalk, and a sub 1 is equal to 2. A sub 2 is equal to the previous value squared, so that's going to be 2, squared plus 1. That's 4 plus 1, which is 5. A sub 3 is equal to the previous value, a sub n minus 1, a sub 2, which is 5 squared plus 1. That's 25 plus 1, which is equal to 26, and so on. So, I'm Mr. True. That's your introduction to sequences, and the next video is going to be about the summation notation, how to use it, what it does, and some factorial symbols. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.